Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Measure of All Things, The 7-Year Odyssey and Hidden Error That Transformed the World by Ken Alder.
In June 1792, in the dying days of the French monarchy, as the world began to revolve around a new promise of revolutionary equality, two astronomers set out in opposite directions on an extraordinary quest. The erudite and cosmopolitan Jean-Baptiste-Joseph Delambre made his way north from Paris, while the cautious and scrupulous Pierre-François-André Méchain made his way south. Each man left the capital in a customized carriage stocked with the most advanced scientific instruments of the day and accompanied by a skilled assistant. Their mission was to measure the world, or at least the piece of the meridian arc which ran from Dunkirk through Paris to Barcelona. Their hope was that all the world's peoples would henceforth use the globe as their common standard of measure. Their task was to establish this new measure, the meter, as 1/10,000,000th of the distance from the North Pole to the equator. The meter would be eternal because it had been taken from the Earth, which was itself eternal. And the meter would belong equally to all the people of the world, just as the Earth belonged equally to them all. In the words of their revolutionary colleague Condorcet, the founder of mathematical social science and history's great optimist, the metric system was to be for all people, for all time. We often hear that science is a revolutionary force that imposes radical new ideas on human history. But science also emerges from within human history, reshaping ordinary actions, some so habitual we hardly notice them. Measurement is one of our most ordinary actions. We speak its language whenever we exchange precise information or trade objects with exactitude. This very ubiquity, however, makes measurement invisible. So it is not surprising that we take measurement for granted and consider it banal. Yet the use a society makes of its measures expresses its sense of fair dealing. That is why the balance scale is a widespread symbol of justice. Our methods of measurement define who we are and what we value. The men who created the metric system understood this. They were the preeminent scientific thinkers of the Enlightenment, an age which had elevated reason to the rank of sole despot of the universe. These savants, as the investigators who studied nature were known in those days, had a modern face looking toward our own times and an older face glancing back toward the past. In their own minds, of course, they were not two-faced. It was their world which was two-faced, with its burdensome past obstructing progress and with a utopian future waiting to be born. The savants were appalled by the diversity of weights and measures they saw all around them. Measures in the 18th century not only differed from nation to nation, but within nations as well. This diversity obstructed communication and commerce and hindered the rational administration of the state. Contemporaries estimated that under the cover of some 800 names, the Ancien Régime of France employed a staggering 250,000 different units of weights and measures. In place of this babble of measurement, the savants imagined a universal language of measures that would bring order and reason to the exchange of both goods and information. Just as the French Revolution had proclaimed universal rights for all people, the savants argued, so too should it proclaim universal measures. And to ensure that their creation would not be seen as the handiwork of any single group or nation, they decided to derive its fundamental unit from the measure of the world itself. For 7 years, Delambre and Méchain traveled the meridian to extract this single number from the curved surface of our planet. They began their journey in opposite directions, and then, when they had reached the extremities of their arc, measured their way back toward one another through a country quickened with revolution. Their mission took them to the tops of filigree cathedral spires, to the summits of domed volcanoes, and very nearly to the guillotine. It was an operation of exquisite precision for such violent times. At every turn, they encountered suspicion and obstruction. How do you measure the earth while the world is turning beneath your feet? How do you establish a new order when the countryside is in chaos? How do you set standards at a time when everything is up for grabs? Or is there, in fact, no better time to do so? At last, their 7 years of travel done, the two astronomers converged on the southern fortress town of Carcassonne, and from there returned to Paris to present their data to an international commission, the world's first international scientific conference. The results of their labors were then enshrined in a meter bar of pure platinum. It was a moment of triumph, proof that in the midst of social and political upheaval, science could produce something of permanence. Accepting the fruit of their labor, France's new supreme ruler made a prophecy. "Conquests will come and go," Napoleon Bonaparte declared. "But this work will endure." In the last 200 years, conquests have indeed come and gone, but the meter has become the measure of all things. The metric system serves today as the common language of high-tech communications, cutting-edge science, machine production, and international commerce. Older forms of measurement have receded as the metric system has made possible trade and economic coordination on a fully global scale. Paradoxically, the leading nation in the global economy remains the sole exception to this rule. Only in recent years have American manufacturers begun retooling for metric units. Few Americans realize that a silent revolution is finally underway in their nation, transforming their measures under the pressures of the new global economy. As things stand, of course, this conversion is embarrassingly incomplete. Americans became painfully aware of this fact in 1999 with the loss of the Mars Climate Orbiter. A NASA investigation into the satellite's failure revealed that one team of engineers had used traditional American units, while another had used metric units. The result was a trajectory error of 60 miles and a $125 million disappearing act. The revolutionary scientists created the metric system 200 years ago to avoid just this sort of fiasco. But behind the public triumph of the metric system lies a long and bitter history. The fundamental fallacy of utopianism is to assume that everyone wants to live in the same utopia. France, it turns out, was not only the first nation to invent the metric system, she was also the first to reject it. For decades after its introduction, ordinary people spurned the new system and clung to their local measures and the local economies they sustained. Not until the middle of the 19th century did France revert to the metric system. What neither advocates nor opponents of the metric system could have known is that a secret error lies at the heart of the metric system. The only people who could have known the full extent of this error were Delambre and Méchain themselves. The south-going astronomer Méchain, despite his extreme caution and exactitude, committed an error in the early years of the Meridian expedition, and worse, upon discovering his mistake, covered it up. Méchain was so tormented by the secret knowledge of his error that he was driven to the brink of madness. In the end, he died in an attempt to correct himself. The meter, it turns out, is an error which has been perpetuated in every subsequent redefinition of its length, including our current definition of the meter, in terms of the distance traveled by light in a fraction of a second. According to today's satellite surveys, the length of the meridian from the pole to the equator equals 10,002,290 meters. In other words, the meter calculated by Delambre and Méchain falls roughly 0.2 millimeters short, or about the thickness of two pages of a book. It may not seem like much, but it is enough to feel with your fingers, enough to matter in high-precision science, and in that slender difference lies a tale of two men sent out in opposite directions on a Herculean task, a mission to measure the world, who discovered that integrity could carry them in directions as contrary as their carriages. This then is a tale of error and its meaning. How people strive for utopian perfection in their works and in their lives, and how they come to terms with the inevitable shortcomings. What does it feel like to make a mistake, and in a matter of such supreme importance? Yet even in failure, Delambre and Méchain succeeded, for by their labor they rewrote our knowledge of the shape of the earth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.